Every decade, there's at least one financial crisis somewhere in the world. When asked what a recession was, Jamie Dimon responded, something that happens every 5 to 7 years. The first documented global financial crisis was in 1825, and they've been a consistent feature of our markets ever since. Financial crises have many causes, but they generally boil down to a few key elements: easy money, poor regulation, and a consensual hallucination that the market always goes up. A disco party where the cocaine is cheap. I prefer Zacapa, but anyways, kicked in the face when I was a kid. Otherwise, I'd be down with the Bolivian marching powder. But anyways, the drug dealers wear Patagonia vests. I don't know why we chose Patagonia, but anyways, and the regulators are passed out on the couch. Three disco parties create asset bubbles, a wave of optimism that lifts prices beyond levels warranted by fundamentals, ending in a crash. The first documented asset bubble was the Dutch tulip mania in 1636, when speculation drove the value of the rarest tulips to 6 times the average salary at the time. The dot-com bubble of the late 90s was another once-in-a-millennium type mania, and I know because I was one of its poster boys, or at least I was participating. Back in 1999, I went to an airfield to browse private jets with other makeshift masters of the universe. I was the genius founder of an internet startup that on paper could afford to spend the equivalent of 1,000 years of my mother's salary on a Gulfstream. This alone should have signaled that the canary in the coal mine was choking, but it didn't. Pre-crash, I attended the World Economic Forum's annual meeting in Davos as internet entrepreneurs were the new masters of the universe. Post-crash, I returned to Davos and went from being Yoda to kryptonite and couldn't get a meeting, couldn't get arrested. I promised myself I'd be smarter the next time if we were on the cusp of a recession. And given that we've just found out about 90% of our viewers are male and the average age is 25, loosely describing that cohort as fucking crazy. By the way, when I was 25, I was still going to church, and the priest told me I was the prettiest boy in the congregation. And you know what? I was touched. Okay, back to the markets. As you get old enough to observe cycles as actual cycles, you begin to recognize that the economic time you're in is a point on a curved line, and the direction of the line can quickly change for better or for worse. Although the natural trajectory of the markets is up, it's about your resilience and your ability to survive that duration. More on that in a moment. Valuation metrics, how much people are willing to pay for a company, are logical indicators of when the market is overheated. During the dot-com mania, the benchmark NASDAQ index's price-to-earnings ratio peaked at, get this, 200. And losing money became a prerequisite of a successful startup. One of the overnight successes that drove NASDAQ's surge was Webvan. Webvan promised grocery delivery within 30 minutes, state-of-the-art fulfillment centers, and advanced robotics. A great idea, but it was 2 decades early. Webvan raised close to $800 million from investors, including Tier 1 VCs and investment banks. The company went public in late 99, doubling in price on the first day of trading and closing at nearly an $8 billion valuation. Even though Webvan generated less than $5 million in revenue and fulfilling orders cost over $27 per order. At its peak in 2000, Webvan had $180 million in sales, but it also had over $500 million in expenses. The firm went bust in 2001. The NASDAQ rose almost sevenfold from 1995 to its peak in March 2000, and the NASDAQ lost 78% of its value by October. So imagine that. The markets could go down by 78%. E-Trade, the Robinhood of the day, grew their client base of retail traders 36-fold from 1996 to 2000. The three legs of the stool of cheap capital, poor regulation, and public delusion are almost as abundant today as they were in 1999. U.S. venture capital funding reached a post-dot-com era high last year with $137 billion invested. And just as regulation gets tightened when things are bad, it also loosens up after a few drinks or in the midst of a mania. Anyways, after the bubble burst and the collapse of Enron, laws including Sarbanes-Oxley were created to protect investors from corporate reporting BS. But the pendulum has swung back, and the SEC allowed companies including Uber, who lost almost $9 billion in 2019, to disclose the much more pleasant-sounding metric of rides-adjusted EBITDA that comes in at a much more palatable $2 billion thus distracting the market from their bloated cost base and terrible business. My favorite example of a BS metric, WeWork's community-adjusted EBITDA, which omitted almost every expense related to running a real estate business. As of 2018, 97% of the S&P 500 companies use these types of unconventional terms. The emergence of SPACs may also be additional canaries, although admittedly, the CEO of the NYSE, Stacey Cunningham, say today's SPACs are not yesterday's. They have better management and more thorough vetting. 2020 has been SPAC's biggest year ever, as investors and companies look to get out into the frothy, warm waters of a market that seems to have huge demand for anything that feels mildly disruptive. What are the stocks that are rocketing? Simply put, story stocks, where the narrative is more important than the numbers. One SPAC turned story stock, Virgin Galactic. The firm promises to send the ultra-wealthy into outer space and is racking up losses in excess of $50 million a quarter trying to finish its spacecrafts. That hasn't stopped the stock price, however, from rallying almost 80% this year. It was up 25% on some Wall Street firms giving it their tick of approval with no substantive news. However, that fails to the story stock of the decade, Tesla. The stock is up almost sixfold this year, and its CEO, Elon Musk, is even saying it's overvalued. Tesla sold $5 billion of its own stock at the peak to strengthen their balance sheet, as they should, and for general corporate purposes. Just like the flurry of E-Trade investors helped drive the bubble of 99, today's fuel is Robinhood. Robinhood usership has exploded in 2020. The firm has grown its user base to 13 million day traders parked up in their parents' basements. To be fair, they're not all day traders. The trading app added 3 million users the 4 months after March, around the same time Google searches for how to buy stocks surged this year, only rivaled in popularity by searches for tech stocks. The story stock of Tesla, trading more on imagination than fundamentals, was a hit amongst Robinhood traders. Tesla's stock price started moving almost in tandem with the number of Robinhood users holding the stock. In sum, if you want to know what Tesla stock will do tomorrow, try and find out how many people signed up for Robinhood accounts today. If there's one name that brings together the trifecta of SPACs and that warm, cuddly feeling of electric vehicles and the rise of the retail investor, it's Nikola Motors. The stock topped the charts of Robinhood, gaining up to 170% after merging with a SPAC. At one point, boasting a market capitalization greater than Ford Motor. However, months later, it appears that Nikola is just that, a hall of mirrors. Another sign that SPACs might be purpose-built for corporate sanitation, Quibi is reportedly exploring options to sell itself by merging with a SPAC. Last year registered the greatest volume of equity issuance in the tech sector since the dot-com bubble. Keep in mind, the longer the party goes, the worse the hangover. And wow, we are in for something vicious. For the NASDAQ, it took 14 years to reach its 2000 peak again. But in reality, it took 17 years and 5 months after accounting for inflation and dividends. The NASDAQ index has a total market capitalization of roughly $17 trillion. If it were to suffer the same bust as the dot-com bust, it would destroy over $13 trillion of value in just 7 months. Over the past decade, the markets turned to the crack of recurring revenues in business-to-business companies. Since August 2013, it's driven the value of emerging cloud companies on the NASDAQ up almost 830%. And to be clear, what's different this time is these are great companies. The question is, have they become a safe harbor that has become a bubble? Following the dot-com bust, it was only the defensive sectors that outperformed, namely utilities, with the utility sector's valuation jumping from 9x earnings at the March peak of dot-com to 23x earnings by November. What are the utilities of today? The railroads of the modern economy are likely Amazon and Netflix. Does that mean they'll rally if this bubble bursts? Well, the prices might already account for that. And so far, these companies have weathered downturns better than other stocks. As a species, we're prone to bubbles. Aspirations, emotions, wishful thinking, greed, optimism, hurting, and confidence are part of our animal spirit, leading to shortcomings in rational decisions. But one thing to remember, while crises are inevitable, that's the bad news. The good news is they always go away. So what to do? Should you sell? I don't know. I can only tell you what I'm doing, as I promised myself I would be smarter the next time I knew things were frothy. I am trying to diversify. I make sure not to put myself in a position where I am a forced seller, meaning that if the market were to go down 30 to 60%, I would not have to sell because of crazy things like margin or a lifestyle based on what my paper holdings are. And also emotionally, I have accepted that I'm likely not as smart as I think I am now. But when the market corrects, I won't be the idiot that the market is telling me. And I will have the financial complexion and the diversity to survive this, just as I didn't survive 1999. It was like a divorce for me. I lost half my wealth, except I still had my wife. Much of our rap is about the need for systemic reform, underregulation of tech oligarchs, higher education enforcing a caste system, and continued assault against the young and the poor. To make real fundamental change, we need to look beyond the symptoms, as many of these are symptoms of the same disease, poor government that needs reform. The best way to bring about change is first and foremost with our everyday actions, and secondly, through exercising your right to democracy. If you were like me and severely rattled by the debate, as in like, what the fuck has happened to us? Then do something about it. The world isn't what it is what you make of it. Register impact. Don't be right, be effective. See above, vote. We'll see you next week.